Hello there, my name is Mr. Money. Today, we are going to have a look at one of the earliest recorded financial bubbles, the South Sea Bubble of 1720. What makes this bubble even more special is the involvement of Sir Isaac Newton. He lost a fortune and we are going to try and estimate how much he lost. So, let us get started. Before we get into the details of the bubble, let's first understand the origins and foundations of the South Sea Company. In the late 17th century and early 18th century, England was engaged in a series of wars, the Nine-Year War lasting from 1688 to 1697, followed by the War of Spanish Succession from 1701 to 1714. These wars dried England's coffers and piled in a national debt of anywhere in between 25 to 30 million pounds. Robert Harley, the then Chancellor of the Exchequer and soon to be the Lord of the Treasurer, was roped in to identify the extent of the national debt. One look and he solved the entire debt issue. Just kidding. He didn't. Or let's say he couldn't. Things weren't quite organized back then. The Bank of England was controlled by the Liberal Whig, which was not in good terms with the Tory government. So, the Whigs kept blocking every legislation that came from the opposing Tories. Result? The House of Commons could not come to the terms of allowing the Bank of England to lend money to the government. This is when Harley turned to Sir John Blunt for help. Blunt was secretary of the Swordbleed Company and had quite a reputation for raising funds. In fact, Blunt already bailed the government once with a lottery scheme, where every ticket holder won a guaranteed prize. The catch? The prize would be distributed over a period of time. The scheme proved to be a hit, and people poured in their hard-earned money. The government was able to raise enough cash to keep things afloat for a short term though. The genius of Blunt in raising money was reflected time and time again. For example, Blunt was interested in Irish real estates. But instead of directly buying the lands he was interested in, he implemented a cunning plan. He offered to exchange Swordbleed Company stocks at a discount for army debentures. Army debentures were debt instruments offered by the government to raise money for war. Since wars aren't always profitable to say the least, army debentures were not considered reliable. When people realized they could exchange such worthless investments for actual stocks, many people who held them were happy to do the transactions. Now here is where Blunt shines. He secretly bought a heap of such worthless army debentures. As people started exchanging army debentures for Swordbleed Company stocks at profit, he started selling his pile of army debentures at a markup for what he bought them, making profit off of them. But now, you would think that he was sitting on supposedly worthless investments, right? No! You see, army debentures were practically government-issued debt. Blunt promptly exchanged the army debentures for the government-held Irish real estates he was interested in. A similar approach of debt equity swap was put into place during the formation of South Sea Company. Blunt became the chief executive and Harley governor of the South Sea Company. The idea was to allow anyone holding government debt, which has risen to a staggering 30 million by now, to convert into shares in the company. The government promised to pay a fixed annual dividend of 6% to the company's stockholders. Unlike the government debt though, South Sea Company was a private entity. This meant, if the South Sea Company turned profitable, the investors can expect much better return compared to what the government was offering on the debt. Additionally, the investors will keep receiving the 6% annual dividend promised by the government. Now it was the job of Blunt to convince the public that the South Sea Company would indeed be profitable. The British government did everything to reinforce confidence in the investors by giving South Sea Company a monopoly to trade in the South and Central America. South and Central America were controlled by Spain, a country Britain was in constant war with. In 1713, Queen Anne of England and King Philip V of Spain signed the Treaty of Utrecht, formalizing the end of Great Britain's involvement in the War of Spanish Succession. Under the treaty, Spain allowed Great Britain to conduct slave trade in the Spanish colonies. This contract was promptly passed on to the South Sea Company. Much before the peace treaty between Great Britain and Spain was brokered, an intensive propaganda campaign headed by notable authors like Daniel Defoe and Jonathan Swift was put into place. The prospects of South Sea Company were hyped much beyond trading slaves, promising investors unimaginable riches and wealth that the company would bring. But what was in it for Blunt? On paper, the South Sea Company was meant to increase England's influence in South America. But for the government, the sole purpose of the South Sea Company was to manage government debt. As in, the South Sea Company would issue stock just to offset the amount of government debt. For example, let's say that the government held a debt of 100 pounds and the South Sea Company stock was trading at 10 pounds. So, the company was supposed to issue 10 shares just enough to offset the government debt. Later, if the price of the stock goes up, the stockholder can make profit by selling the stock they have already bought. All sounded good, right? But not all believed that Blunt would hold on to the promise. People who knew Blunt knew that if price goes up, Blunt himself being one of the stockholders would stop at nothing to maximize his profits. Rightly so, people started questioning the concept of transferring the entirety of debt to a single private entity. Such opposing voices were either silenced by bribes or thrown in prison. Even powerful people, the likes of Sir Robert Walpole, saw themselves behind bars. So was the charm of Blunt that he was able to rope in the King and Monarch George I by his side. With the King himself seen singing the tunes of South Sea Company, the company was viewed as too big to fail. With all the buzz Blunt managed to create, he was all set to rocket the stock price of South Sea Company to the moon. But remember, the South Sea Company was capped to issue the number of stock just enough to offset the government debt, right? Did it stop Blunt? It didn't. With all the enthusiasm created for the South Sea Company, money poured in, and the company was able to offset the debt quite early on. As expected, the government had to make a choice: to allow South Sea Company to further issue stocks or to stop the sale of the stocks as decided during the inception of the company. Blunt, he wanted more. He used every trick he knew to convince the government to keep the frenzy going. At one point, he offered the Member of Parliament the South Sea Company stocks, where the MPs were not expected to make an upfront payment towards buying the stock. The caveat: the MPs would pay for the stock only when they sell their stocks. In other words, the MPs would make money if the stock went up. This way, Blunt made sure that enough MPs and in turn the Parliament turned a blind eye to the clauses that were going to keep South Sea Company and Blunt in check. Blunt knew how to have his way. By bribing, threatening, or straight out promising rainbows and unicorns. Sadly though, many drank his Kool-Aid. Many, including our good old Newton. That's it for this episode. In the next episode, we will start having a closer look at how Newton sailed or got wrecked through the worst financial bubble of his time. Goodbye.